Hey, family, friends, how you doing out there? Brothers and sisters in Yahweh, you know, children of the Most High, how are you? I just want to drop in. I'm Drew L. Murray. That's D-R-U, L as my middle initial. Murray, M-U-R-R-A-Y. I just want to touch base on the real names of God and Jesus. Straight out of your traditional King James Bible here. Don't laugh at mine. It gets a lot of use, okay? I do consider it sacred and holy to some points. And it's also a history book for me. A way of life to a certain extent. But we're just going to talk about the names of God, the real names of God and Jesus, straight out of your traditional King James Bible here, okay? So, when I was studying the other day, I always ask God, like, why is there a big capital Lord, L-O-R-D? That's the Lord of Lords. If he's going to be called Lord, I capitalize all the letters too. But then there's a Jehovah, big capitalized, you know, Jehovah, all caps. When we know in the Hebrew language, in the times of the conception of the book and of the inspiration, there was no J's. That's a whole nother teaching. But in the language for Jehovah to even have that name, his name is Yahweh, okay? And there was no vowels in the, we'll get into all that, you know, that's another intense teaching. Not intense, nothing is intense with Yahweh. It's just more, you want to just speak about the language and learn the Hebrew and learn some of the words that mean Hebrew, like we're going to do today. I have nothing else here around me. I was able to, I'm going to do that for you right now. Just get the... Let me see if it's in here. I want to get the World's Dictionary, which is the Webster's the World's Bible, which is the Webster's Dictionary. I just want to look up the word Jesus for you and see if I get the same thing I got out of the other one I read the other day. That way, you know, you can see where these teachings are coming from. You can see that these teachings were introduced to whoever not inspired the Bible or wrote the Bible, but whoever published the Bible and published the dictionary. Okay. So right back here, after I... in the Bible. Let's see if the name Jesus is in here. I know it's in the other one I have. I'll have to go over and get that one. Okay. So, it says in that Bible, Jesus is the Savior of men. Oh, you can take my word for it. You can Google it. Let me see if I can find my other little dictionary here and see if it's going to say the same thing over here. Well, when I looked up the dictionary, in the dictionary the other day, it said, I think I had Googled it, and it said, Jesus is of Greek origin, Latin origin, okay? It said that this is the word, not the person, not the figure in the Bible, this is just the word Jesus. It says that it is a rendition of the Hebrew name Yeshua. Why not keep his name Yeshua? Why do you have to remake his name over? Why do you have to make people forget who his real name was? Why do you have to give people another name, Jesus? That is, when you do your history with Zeus and Jesus, they're more like one of the same. Christ is the anointing of God. You and I could be anointed, but if we put Zeus the anointing, we'd be honoring Zeus, right? But if we say Christ the anointing of Yahweh, then we know this Christ that came into the world, This Yeshua, came into the world as a representative of Yahweh, not Zeus, not the Roman Greek culture or mythological gods and stories of that nature. Let me just see if it's going to be in here. Anyway, you can believe, you can trust me and believe that I've seen that definition. And it is online. It, when you look up what's the meaning of Jesus, and it'll give you the definition. It's a rendition of a Hebrew name, Yeshua. So I said, wow, why would they keep going out of their way to discredit Jesus, to discredit Yeshua, to cover up who he is? Why would the people in slavery get the religion Christianity in the God Jesus to serve? It has a lot to do with, if you read, you have to get the Apocrypha, and that when you look up that definition, it'll tell you it is biblical doctrine, but it's not true. Why would God let any biblical doctrine come down from heaven and it not be true? Because somebody is trying to keep the truth from you. But if you read 2 Maccabees chapter 6, it tells you about Eleazar, and it tells you about them trying to force him to eat meat, and he refused to do it. He said he would not break his covenant with Yahweh and serve an alien religion, which they had already imposed Christianity on the early children of Israel at that point in time, on the Jewish people at that point in time. So, I always consult with my daughter because we live together, and I just love to share things with people and show them revelation and just truth that's probably already been here. But again, like from Genesis to Revelation, it seems like a Greek Bible, but in between, they left enough information in here to say, oh my God, who will go through this length to try to distort the holy book in the Bible and the Word of God? They can never distort the Word of God, but anything inspired, given to you to write, and you write it, you give it to somebody to publish, they put their own culture, their own tradition, their own thought process in there, then you could very well be following their ways, their God. So there's some truth to it here. But anyway, I immediately ran to the book of Joshua, to the book of Isaiah, to the book of Malachi, who was the last prophet prophesying Christ to come. And when I went to the book of Malachi, you can go there if you have your Bibles. I do believe there's enough of God's word to penetrate you, empower you, give you revelation if you read it from the text itself and not from your laptop or your tablet or online. If you can get yourself to, a Bible, it's always better to read from the actual text itself, the Word of God. So, Malachi is right before Matthew in the Bible. And I have one of these, it's a King James Reference Translation one. It's not the 1611, which you can find copies online. It doesn't have the Apocrypha, Book of Jasher, Book of Jubilee, Enoch, any of that in it, or the Book of Maccabees. But we're going to see that this Bible mentions the Book of Maccabees today, because I came across that trying to find out if the real name of God and Jesus was in the same self-set Bible that we both are supposed to be studying from, to show ourselves approved unto God, not a workman needed to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth, okay? So, as I'm reading the commentation about the book of Malachi, it tells you that Malachi, he's a prophet in the days of Nehemiah. He directs his message of judgment to people plagued with corrupt priests, wicked practices, and false sense of security in their privileged relationship with God. Sounds like a lot of you pastors out there today. It sounds like a lot of leaders, teachers, people that are just out there leading God's people still astray, because you won't admit that you have some issues, or how you may have been taught wrong, or you may not know everything about God, and you won't seek out for help. Because again, your privileged relationship with God allows you to feel like you got it all together, and you arrive, and we see you slowly falling, being plucked back in the hand of the enemy real quick. You rise to the top and then you fall off. And Jesus Christ talks about people being like that. You know, he talks about a sower went out to sow seed amongst the rocks. Soil that got choked up by Satan. Soil that got choked up by the cares of the world. So we have to be careful and really get into learning what really Yahweh, the covenant, the truth of us all is. Okay? But it says in here, he probes deeply into their problems, hypocrisy, infidelity, mixed marriages. Because at one point, God wanted the bloodline to be pure, because he knew that out of the tribe of Judah shall spring forth Christ. And if the, just like the queen over there tried to, you know, mimic what God does now, keep her bloodline royal. Thanks be to Meghan Markle, who is not the first black to be up in the palace, but bringing us back into our rightful place. Can I get a hallelujah-way? Hallelujah-way. Yes, hallelujah-way. Absolutely. Hallelujah-way. Can I get a hallelujah-way? Can I get a hallelujah-way? Yes. She's just bringing us back into our rightful place, okay? So anyway, divorce, false worship, and arrogance. This is what you see. Malachi wrote this book 450 years probably before Jesus came. Isaiah probably prophesied his 700 years before Christ sat in the chair in the temple. And all this time, we 2,000 years removed from Christ, and we still going through all of this. Things are so simple. Has the nation become this? God's word to the people no longer have any impact. It has no impact. This, you know, and it's that way today. So yes, we have to speak up. We have to take our time, and we have to look at this. Remember, the real names of God and Jesus write in this book, and we want to know why people who gave the early slaves this book to read would take, we got it 150 years ago. They had it 430 years when we first went into slavery. Matter of fact, if you do the research, even though King James and Shakespeare had a relationship, King James was trying to get the 1611 copy to the right people so that they can have a relationship with God. People were planning against God's people since Psalms 83. You have to read it. And then in 1640, people get sold into slavery. We do. This was a conspiracy that went on for years, and a lot of people took part in it. And if we go back line by line, precept by precept, we'll understand why, and we'll get some of our truth so that we can be free, so that we can breathe, so that we can say, oh, okay, this happened, but I don't got to be uptight about it, and this is what I can do about it to keep it from happening. Because if not, this stuff still goes on today. So, and it goes on to say, for 400 years after Malachi's ringing commandments, God remains silent. So they put this in here. Now, you can believe that if you want to. You have your major prophets, you have your minor prophets, and then you have another section of the book. I don't really know what it's called, but it's where the Apocrypha and all this other stuff, the Book of Maccabees and all these other prophets and the wars and stories that happened to the children of Israel before Jesus even came on the scene is really missing. If you're entitled to believe, you're entitled to believe that that God was silent for 400 years, but my spirit would allow me to believe he keeps on talking. Because one thing God wants to do is keep reeling his people back into him. He never wants to leave you astray. And see, and if he's not sending any prophet and not talking to you, you stay out serving other gods, serving paganism, following the Baals and Balaams and Jezebels of the church today. These false prophets and wicked teachers that have no godliness in them at all, according to what this Bible is saying. When you see some of the things they do and you see if it lines up with the word and it doesn't line up, that's not godliness right there, okay? And we have to be mindful of that. And so anyway, I just wanted to figure out, well, let me see what Malachi, you know, the commentation had to say about Malachi. So the meaning of the name Malachi, my messenger, and that's M-A-L, and a lot of times in the Hebrew, in this Bible, when you see a word M-A-L with an accent, like that apostrophe in between letters, they don't do that with Jesus and they don't do that with Satan in certain areas. But even in this Bible, it shows you that there is an apostrophe over Jesus' name. So if we're going to say Jesus, why not say Jesus? Because in English, we learn short sounding vowel, long sounding vowel, J-E, with no other vowel or Y behind it, is a short sounding Jeff, like neck, heck, bet. So we got the name wrong right there with Jesus anyway. It should be Jesus and not Jesus, okay? But anyway, so it goes on to say, shortened for Malachi, messenger of Yahweh. Of who? Yahweh. Who's Yahweh? Who was he messaging for? Every prophet in his Bible was a messenger of God, they would tell you. But God has a name. His name is Yahweh right here. But see, the early people who had this book and published this book and gave it to you to believe that it's your culture, your tradition, and religion, and your way, and your covenant with Yahweh, went through this whole Bible, and where it should be Yahweh, put God, and where it should be Yahweh, put Jehovah, and where it should be Yahweh, possibly put Lord, okay? And we have to understand that if I go, that was Malachi. Let me just say this. We have to know that if we're going to, there's a lot of gods out there. So if we don't start narrowing God down to who he really is, in our ignorance, he'll save us, deliver us, keep us, and be faithful for us. But he wants us to be faithful, keep ourselves, guard his word and his covenant in our heart so that we can contend the faith. And you know, the kingdom of violence suffers, the kingdom of God suffers violence, the violent take it by force. We're not doing that because we don't want to get into his word. We don't want to get into his covenant. These people were in covenant with God when they fought all their battles and beat all their enemies and rose to the occasion. That's why Psalms 83 says the enemy conspired against everybody to make them forget God's name. So we can forget, and God's name is Yahweh, so we can forget how we really overcame, broke through, rose to the top, and was, you know, like Winston Churchill says, some people like the Jews and some people didn't, but there's not a thoughtful man in the world, paraphrasing, who could not say they were not a formidable and remarkable race that ever appeared in the world. That's you and I. Mark Twain says, what is the immortality? What is the immortality of a Jew? And as I wrote in my book to answer his question yesterday, he said, what is the secret of their immortality? He said, the Egyptians, the Babylonians, the Persians, all rose, all filled the earth with splendor and with something else. Just paraphrasing here. And then he goes on to say, then the Roman and the Greek come along, fill it with a vast noise, and all passed away. But the Jew is still here. Every man is mortal, but the Jew. What is it with the Jew? And it's the secret to the Jew's immortality. I say Yahweh in our covenant. We just gonna keep waxing strong, growing bigger. That's why Pharaoh didn't like us. We outnumber him. He got us in slavery, but our tribes grew bigger than him. He got mad and started killing us off. And there's some truth to this religion. Yahweh's name is in the book of Malachi. It's right here in the commentary section. It says that Malachi is a messenger of Yahweh. Now, if you want to flip just to Zechariah, I didn't check this. I checked two other places. But if you check Zechariah in the commentary, we're not going to go into what Zechariah, because he was about rebuilding the temple and everything. But it always tell you at the commentary, Hebrew, Greek, and Latin, for whatever reason, when God inspired everything in Hebrew. So Zechariah means Yahweh remembers, or Yahweh has remembered. So why not just keep Yahweh's name where God's name is throughout the Bible, so people can get trained and used to calling him Yahweh and not God? Oh no, because we're going to keep on going back to Genesis the first, and then we're going to visit Revelation, and I'm going to show you why. This is a Greek thing. This is a Roman thing. The books that's missing out the Bible, that your dictionary, the world's Bible, the dictionary will say is biblical doctrine, but is not genuine, is not real. That's what's missing out of your Bible to make your life line up with the Word of God so you can enjoy your truth. They want you to believe what they're giving you because some of your life history is missing. How are you going to manage? Oh my God. How are you going to be able to prosper? Some people know how to manipulate money and get you the weak sheep to feed their flock at home, okay? They get you to take care of them, okay? That's what these ministries are doing today. They feel kind of bad that they used you and took advantage of you to get to where they are, but God don't feel that bad for you and I, because we got to get in this word. We got to stop treating people, letting people treat us that way and take advantage of us. That's why he says study, and they won't be able to do that to you anymore. You'll be able to see their stocks come down and your stocks go up. You belong to a local church? By all means, you support that church. I'll give you 10%. Give a little offering because you want to keep the church doors open. But you don't want to take any care of anybody's life. When you know what the kingdom of God it really is, and what the sower really went out to sow, he didn't say he sold money. It didn't say he sold none of that. It said he sold seeds, words. Some fell around the thorn on the rock, didn't last. Some on soil, Satan choked up the word. Some in good soil, but they got drawn away by their own lust, their own cares of the world. And then some in good soil, where we really trying to understand and rightly divide the word of truth, build kingdoms and people, and not churches in the world. Okay. Hello. Anyhow, how you doing? Yes, face YouTube. Excuse me. Drew L. Murray. DRULMURRAY. Thank you very much. Don't make my name great in the world, though. This is all just for subscribe, like, go to Facebook, follow me. This is to make Yahweh's name great in the land again, because God has been simply forgotten about. Even in Christian religion and Christianity, it's all about Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus has a creator, and his name is Yahweh, as we see right here. So, all in between Revelations and Romans, we can kind of go back. Zephaniah, Yahweh hides. Yahweh has hidden. Sometimes Yahweh take himself and remove himself from our presence, but he never goes silent, because we brothers and sisters supposed to be in the earth encouraging one another about Yahweh. Even if he goes silent today, we should have enough word in us to carry one another through. What do you think our ancestors did? They didn't go to church every Sunday. They went up to the temple maybe once a year to make sacrifice and offerings. And then when Jesus came, they went to the temple frequently, what? To pray. not to gather and forsake not the fellowships of the assemblies and all this stuff. They want to pray to Yahweh. We got things so much confused and backwards. But even Zephaniah. And okay, if you want to go ahead and, now Habakkuk, it doesn't really mention Yahweh. Let me just scan real quick. But it says it's an unusual Hebrew name. This is Habakkuk. And it doesn't spell it. It got Q's and U's and all that in here. It's not spelled the Greek way. It's one who embraces. Could very well. And then it says to cling firmly to God. It says, okay, at the end of this book, this name becomes appropriate because Habakkuk chooses to cling firmly to God regardless of what happens to his nation. Okay, and then it goes again, the Greek. Who needs anything Greek in this Bible if God inspired it in Hebrew for you to understand it at that time? And at this time too. Because maybe if you heard something from God in Greek, like them Dead Sea Scrolls over there or something, like the Maccabee books and the Apocrypha and Jubilee, your spirit, your mind would be like, wait, this sounds more like my culture, my religion than what you've been given. But if you keep on going, Nahum, N-A-H-U-M, is the comfort of Yahweh. The comfort of who? Not God, but Yahweh. Can you see Yahweh's name here? Okay, so we know God is Yahweh. Okay, we know that. Micah, who is like Yahweh. Okay, I'm just going backwards. Jonah, where's Jonah at? And what does it say? Anything about Yahweh? Yonah is a Hebrew word for dove. Jonah, it's got Y-O-N-A-H. Why are all these names translated out into Greek? If it starts out in Hebrew, who hashtag religion winked you to get you to learn Greek? It's all been passed down in tradition. Absolutely. Because Obadiah, Hebrew name Obadiah means worshiper of Yahweh. These people worship Yahweh. We're gonna just keep on going back. Because we have Amos. Amos is derived from the Hebrew root Amos. This is all right out of the King James Reference Translation Bible I have here. This is all out of here. It says that to lift the burden. This name means burden or burden bearer. Okay? Amos lives up to declaring judgment to the rebellious. Alright, Amos lives up to the meaning of his name by bearing up under his divinely given burden of declaring judgment to rebellious Israel. Then he got the Greek and Latin titles. Who cares about the Greek and Latin titles at this point in time? Or the English translation? Because even the book of Sirach says when you translate out Hebrew, you do not get the same meaning. So, thank God they left the names and enough in this book for us to say, okay, where's the cover up at? Something isn't adding up right here. Because, like I said, in the middle of the Bible, Joel, Yahweh is God. The Hebrew name is Yoel, Y-O-E-L, means Yahweh is God. Let's see what Hosea means. All these names in this Bible mean something of God. We all are an extension. All are a messenger of some sort until we get to Christ the Messiah and we get all this confusion. Why? Because he came to deal with some things in this world like sin that and to redeem us and deliver us from the hand of the enemy. Well, Hosea. It says the names Hosea, Joshua, and Jesus, American Jesus, are all derived from the same Hebrew root word. Mm-mm. The word Hoshea means salvation, but Joshua and Jesus included an additional idea, Yahweh is salvation. All right, look up the word Jesus. It's going to tell you J-E-S-U-S originated from the Greek, and it's a rendition, a version of the Hebrew name. Yeshua is said in I think I Googled it online. You can find it. It's out there. So this right here, Jesus is all a rendition. Jesus is not derived from the Hebrew root word. It's not, but it does mean Yahweh is salvation, okay? It's likened unto Joshua. Yeshua. That's the real name. Can you see Yeshua? Because Yeshua, we're going to get to Joshua's book and tell you what Joshua's name said. But Joshua and Yeshua sounds alike. Joshua, and just like God and Jesus sound totally apart, but Yahweh and Yeshua sounds more like close proximity and relation, right? Yeah, so Hosea means salvation of Yahweh. We can look and see who Daniel was. And then we're going to jump around here a little bit because I don't want to keep you too long. But, okay. So now Daniel, we get to Daniel. And we just see that Daniel means God is my judge. Why not use Yahweh as my judge there? Because they don't want to be judged by Yahweh, whoever put this book together. Can you see where we going here? They leave some things in, enough truth to depict their lies, but then they cover up enough of God's truth to make us all confused for 2,000 years plus so later, and we just got to look at the words for what they are. Everywhere else, up until Daniel, because nobody wants the book of Daniel prophesied some things about this world. Nobody wants Yahweh to be their judge, so just throw God there, okay? But God is my judge is what Daniel means. Yahweh is my judge. Why not leave that there? So let's see what the prophet Ezekiel say. And then we're going to get like to Isaiah, Jeremiah, Joshua. And then we're going to go to Genesis and Revelation. Just to show you how this book somehow went from a Hebrew foundation to now the number one best-selling Greek book in the world. This is a Greek book with the inspiration of God's words being sold in it, uncovered and masked up by some of their words and traditions. But it says here that the Hebrew name Yehezekiel, like Y-E-H-E-Z-K-E, apostrophe, accent, L. Why? Even Ezekiel name, even the names that begin with E started with a Y. So if you take the name off of Jesus, the J, leave it, and you get that little yeah, you get the Y-E, right? You get into where I'm going with that. They just changed that sus. No, you can't change somebody's name. Your name is your name. Anybody trying to, I do apologize about that. Anybody trying to take your name, cover up your name because they don't want you to remember or don't want your name to be great in the land as someone from God, someone from Yahweh, someone of the children of Israel is wrong. And it can be addressed. But we see here that the name, it says, means God strengthens me. See, they want to be strengthened by Zeus. They don't want to be strengthened by Yahweh. Remember, Zeus and Hercules is their God. So when it comes to being judged and when it comes to being strengthened, just throw God there. Because here, they can plug in Zeus. You can plug in Jesus. You can plug in whoever here. But they don't give Yahweh credit. And these are the people we've read. From Malachi up to Daniel and Ezekiel, these guys don't get credit. Yahweh don't get credit in their book. Why? Because it means strengthen, and because it means judge. In Daniel, it means judge. Ezekiel, strength. They got their judge and their strength. That's why they're mocking your God and your strength in Yahweh. Lamentations. Okay. We got a Hebrew title called Echa. Ah, how. It's like I-H-H, how. Ah, how. Yeah, limitations. And then another Hebrew word, Gnoth, Elegies. Then they go into the Greek, tears, lament. Okay, so they have some Hebrew derivation, some derivative here in limitations. A lot of your Bible, if you have the cross-reference, is telling you right in your face that it's all based off of Hebrew. So how does it get translated out? And who gave them the right to translate it out? And how did they get the Bible to translate it out? And who did they kill to get the... You know, just keep asking yourself those questions. Because we're getting there. I just want to look at Jeremiah, Isaiah, and see what it says. Jeremiah who? With a Y. Yerem, or it can be Jeremiah. Y-I-R-M-E-Y-A-H. Jeremiah in the Hebrew literally means Yahweh throws. Perhaps in sense of laying a foundation. It may effectively mean Yahweh establishes. We're back to Yahweh now. Okay. But when it comes to strength and when it comes to being a judge, oh, let's put God there. Now when it comes to him throwing down his foundation, oh, let him be Yahweh again, right? Okay. There's enough discrepancies, enough innuendos, enough truth to say, look, I don't want to be evil anymore in here. Let's start there. There's enough truth in here to say, look, I don't want to be a wicked soul anymore. But then there's enough truth once your soul isn't wicked anymore for you to go on this journey and say, wait a minute. Why they go out their way to just try to, Psalms 83, cover everything up, make you forget who you are as a nation, and make you forget you're Israel? Yep. Absolutely. But then God says, on the other hand, if you want to be disobedient, running after them, eating pork, hanging out with Baal, Jezebel, Balak, and all these other gods of sexual immorality and stuff like that, go ahead. He says, I'll give my commandments and my name to somebody else. And it's biblical. It's in the Apocrypha. It's in all kinds. God says, I will let somebody else use my order. As long as you obey my commands, my ordinance, statutes, and that's what the Jewish people are doing over in Israel. They're obeying God more than we are, and that's why their land, even though they're fighting, they prosper more than us, because they obey the commandments. Some follow Christianity, but others stick to their true roots, and they're told that they're blessed. We can't hate on that. But let's see what Isaiah says. So now, Yeshu, in its shortened form, Yeshahaya, like it's Isaiah with Y-E-S-H in the front of it instead of the I-S, mean Yahweh is salvation. Here we go again. Yahweh is salvation. Here we go again. You know, and you can just keep on going through this book, seeing the original Greek in it. But let me go to Joshua now, because I was just going backwards, and I'm like, I didn't even bother stop to see what 2 Samuel and all of that is, because it says the first book, 2 Samuel, were originally one book in Hebrew Bible known as the Book of Samuel, or simply Samuel. This has been variously translated the name of God, the name of Yahweh. Hello? Remember, Hannah prayed for a baby and said, Lord, if you give me a child, I will dedicate him to you. He got the name Samuel, and the name Samuel pretty much means in the Hebrew, the name of Yahweh. Go figure. It's all right here. I'm getting all of this right out of the Holy Bible there. Yeah, don't laugh at mine. We get some working around here. But I've had it for years, and it's kind of falling apart. So if you want to go ahead and help me get an Apocrypha and the original Bible, I would greatly appreciate that. I sure will. You can find some of the information down underneath the screen there, under the video. But, you know, so I didn't really stop to see what Samuel and everything says. But I know Joshua, I call him Yahshua, and Yeshua sounds closely alike. So I went right back to Joshua, and it says here, the title of this book is appropriately named after its central figure. It got Joshua here, okay? His original name is Hoshea. Hoshea means salvation, okay? But Moses evidently changes it to Yehoshua. Yehoshua, like Yeshua. Yehoshua. 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 Yahweh is salvation. How come it is that the Buddha will call theirs the Buddha? They don't get no name change. The Dalai Lama is the Dalai Lama. The Hindu God is the Hindu God. Allah is revered and called Allah from his worshipers. Why can't we just call God by his name? If everybody that believe in God today just yell out and scream Yahweh, share, like, let this video go around. Just get the name of Yahweh out there again. He's still God. He is the God of the Bible. He just has all these different names we just seen. He goes by the name of Jack. It's Yahweh is salvation. So I went to the book of Genesis, okay? Because, you know, in Greek we say Alpha and Omega, and they tell you that Jesus is the first and the last. Alpha and Omega. Well, so isn't there Zeus, and so isn't there Hercules, and so isn't there everybody else over there they worship. And when they trying to get you to worship their God, indirectly they'll give you a God that you still call God, but we strip him of his name, strip him of his titles, strip him of all of this stuff here, and reduce you down to just serving any God when the name of God is in the Bible. So I go to the book of Genesis. I'm like, Lord, I'm about to find your name in the book of Genesis. You are the Alpha and the Omega, right? So you should be in Genesis and you should be in the book of Revelations. Honey, as I get to reading, let me just go ahead. Genesis, the first part of Genesis. The first part of Genesis. How many parts of Genesis is there? This says the first part of Genesis focuses on the beginning and spread of sin in the world and culminates in the devastating flood in the days of Noah. The second part of the book focuses on God's dealing with one man, Abraham, through whom God promises to bring salvation and blessing to the world. Abraham and his descendants learned firsthand that it is always safe to trust the Lord in times of famine and feasting, blessing and bondage. From Abraham to Isaac to Jacob to Joseph, God promises. We back to God now. We back to just a regular name, okay? Just a title. God is just a title. It's actually dog backwards, D-O-G. So if that helps you to stop calling him God and start calling him Yahweh again, maybe you set yourself apart from serving this other culture that comes out in your Bible. And this manipulation and this deriving away from the truth of God. So it says that God's promises begin to come to fruition in a great nation possessing a great land. So we're back to God here. All in the middle of the Bible is Yahweh. Some places is God. See, it took a long time for people to sit down and go line by line, precept by precept, to manipulate the word of God, to make the word of God, you know, so we don't line up with it. So we be pressing with this religion, pressing with a relationship. Yes, God knows we reaching out to that God, to him, but we got to be more specific and more precise. So it says here, Genesis is a Greek word. Greek, here we go, Alpha and Omega, Greek words. Why not say the beginning and the end when it comes to your God? You're not Greek. Stop following the Greek. Oh, he's the Alpha and Omega. He's Greek. That God is Greek. That Jesus is Greek. That Zeus is Greek. Yahweh is the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Yes, let's get away from this Greek tradition. So Genesis. And this is why I say, listen, because I'm glad I got the commentary and the translation and the reference Bible. Because this even breaks it down. Even though it's wrong and they say King James did us dirty, gave us a dirty Bible, and screwed God's people out of their inheritance, it's right here. All we got to do is read it and believe it. Genesis is a Greek word. But everything else was telling you was Hebrew, right? Let's figure it out. Meaning origin, source, generation, and beginning. The original Hebrew title, Bereshit, means in the beginning. Why can't we just go back to in the beginning, the Hebrew word, in the beginning? Why we gotta title it Genesis? Because the Greek word means origin, source, generation. God just says it means the beginning. The beginning. The beginning of man's life in the earth, because man was with God before we came here. That's a whole nother teaching. But anyway, so the literary structure of Genesis is clear and is built around 11 separate units, each including the word generations in the phrase. These are the generations, or the book of generations, introductions to genealogies, heaven and earth, Noah, the sons. We got Shem here. Got Shem here. We got Ishmael here. We got Isaac here. We got Esau here. We got Jacob here. We got Terah. A lot of people don't know about Terah. T-E-R-A-H. We got some genealogies here that'll probably take us back further than slavery. That'll probably take us back further than Jesus. Take us back further than Noah, some of the names here. Yeah. Even got Adam's name there. So, the book of Genesis mentioned nothing of Hebrew, but nothing of God deriving from a Hebrew name like Genesis means. It just means in the beginning of Yahweh. In the beginning of God. It doesn't mean that, excuse me, Alpha and Omega. It doesn't mean that Alpha and Omega, okay? We have to get away from that. Because when you go to Omega and look at the book of Revelations, you'd be like, why these people put the first book and the last book to say is Greek and have Greek meaning, but everything else still derives from a Hebrew heritage, ancestry, and origination, okay? This is only going by their commentary and what they put in here for us to read. Nobody I know of went and made another Bible up and called it their own Bible, but there's some stories out there that people have put their name on the Bible, faces and things like that, and made the Bible their own. I'm just going by what was given to me to study from. So, it tells you that just as Genesis, the book of Revelation, just as Genesis and Revelation has a lot to do with one another, people. Let me tell you, and I have a story to share with you where some of Revelation looked like it played out already, came to pass, should be in the beginning, but they got it put in the back here. Okay, just as Genesis is the book of beginnings, Revelation is the book of consummation, excuse me. In it, the divine program of redemption is brought forth to fruition. And the holy name of God back to God again. It doesn't want you to remember in the back of the book, neither in the beginning about Yahweh, nor in the back of the book about Yahweh. Are you following me? This is the regular King James Version here. Before it was translated out to the American and the New King James and everything. This is the 100. This ain't even the 1611 one, which have more truth than this one. But it's back to God again at the end of the book. So you in slavery for all these years, you're just reading God at the end, God in the beginning. And you're not really reading what's in the middle, because now you're following pastor and listening to what pastor say, and pastor calling them God, and then worshiping Jesus more than Yahweh himself, who sent us all here to this earth, okay? So, boy, I would love to give you the Hebrew translation of it. But basically, Revelation is the only New Testament book that focused primarily on prophetic events. Why would God spend all his time prophesying in the beginning before Christ came to have now be prophecy? And listen to what the prophecy says. Listen to what it says about, let me just go ahead and read this all to you. Although there are numerous prophecies in the Gospels and Epistles, Revelation is the only New Testament book that focuses primarily on prophetic events. Its title means unveiling or disclosure. Thus, the book is an unveiling of the character and program of God. We back the character and program of God, not Yahweh, okay? Can you see what they tried to manipulate with this book? And they said, if you want to hide the truth from people, especially the people they were trying to conspire against, put it in the book, because they thought we would never read it or dissect it or have a mind of wisdom like God to read through their conspiracy. It's right here. So, it goes on to say, penned by John during his exile on the island of Patmos, Revelation centers around visions and symbols of the resurrected Christ, who alone has authority to judge the earth, to remake it, and to rule it in righteousness. Hear me out. The title of this book in the Greek, back to the Greek text, is Apocalypse. I am now Revelation of John. It says the Revelation of John. Now, I was taught Revelation means the unveiling of Christ, the disclosure of Christ. It is also known as the Apocalypse, a transliteration of the word apocalypsis, meaning unveiling, disclosure, or revelation. Thus, the book is an unveiling of that which otherwise could not be known. A better title comes from the first verse, Apocalypsis Isaios Christos, Revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation of Jesus Christ. Where do we get Jesus from? The name Jesus comes from the origin of Greek. When you compare the word Jesus and Zeus and what they did, there's a lot of comparisons. If you look at the Roman Empire and the Greek Empire, they wanted Zeus to sit on the Mount of Jerusalem and Gerizim. There's another mount that Jacob blessed his sons with to have and to rule over. But it's all in your Bible. But anyway, it says, this could not be taken as a revelation which came from Christ or as a revelation which is about Christ. It says this could be taken as a revelation which came from Christ or as a revelation which is about Christ. Both are appropriate. Because of the unified contents of this book, it should not be called revelations. It should just be called. There was a lot of different revelations going on here. Did these revelations happen throughout the Bible? Did some happen in the beginning where Genesis is? Does something happen for us to still be looking for the return of Christ to come? Absolutely. But when you have somebody taking this Bible and manipulating it to their liking, we have to step back and say, okay, wait a minute. We heard Yahweh all through the Bible, but in Genesis we hear God. When it talks about strength, we hear God. When it talks about being a judge, we hear God. Revelations, we hear God. And they put Jesus Christ in there because Jesus, that part of it, is their God. They want you to focus on Jesus. They don't want you to focus on Yahweh in the beginning or in the end. How would it be for you? So, with that being said, I really hope this blessed you, and I really hope that this opened up your eyes to say that, yes, Yeshua, Yahweh, is in the same Bible we read every Sunday. Get the commentary Bible, reference and translations. You look up a verse and it'll give you 2, 3, 4 of the verses. It'll give you commentary, and it'll tell you exactly why each book was prescribed and inspired by God to that particular prophet and person of that time. So yes, educate yourself. Know that Alpha and Omega is Greek. Know that Genesis and Revelations are Greek words. Know that their beginning and their end is for you, and you've been living their beginning and their end. You have to find out your beginning and your end, which is with Yahweh, and which will end with the King of Righteousness and the King of Shalom, who is Christ the Anointed One, who came as Yeshua. So yes, indeed, we just have to change our titles up. And that's freedom in and of itself. I am sitting here so free right now, sharing this truth with you. With that being said, may God bless you. May Yahweh bless you, keep you, make his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you, let his countenance fall on you, rest on you, and his shalom peace be in you. Because like I said, here we talk it up to Yah, we talk it up to Yahweh, we have our tea, whatever. I don't judge anybody. With good news of the kingdom of God and no shade. You stand with Yahweh, you can't get burnt. But if you stand in with other gods, you're at risk of being burnt. Nonetheless, God, Yahweh, is faithful and just to cleanse us of all unrighteousness and to forgive us of all our sins. There, I said it right finally. God bless you. Thank you so much. And remember, the real names of God and Jesus is Yahweh and Yeshua, all right? Yahweh and Yeshua. And if you look at the names of the prophets, they all were given names that meant something back to Yahweh. Yahweh is strength. Yahweh is strong. Yahweh is judge. Yahweh is salvation. Yahweh is redeemer. Yahweh, you know, it all goes back to Yahweh. His name is all throughout the Bible. When you start just reducing him down to God, which is a title spelled backwards, D-O-G, he lose our reverence, we lose value. We just out here supporting a religion and relationship with God that's not even for us. Because remember, Alpha and Omega, they want you to remember their beginning and their end for you. God has, he knows, Jeremiah 29:11 says, my thoughts are higher than yours. My ways are higher than yours. The thoughts I have towards you are peace, not evil. See, God never meant evil for us. He would always want you to know that he's God. He would never send you anything to condemn you, oppress you, or keep you in bondage. But other people know how to get their hands, manipulate the situation, the world, for greed, gain, fame, to be where they are, seated in wicked places and high wickedness in high places. So just open your eyes. Be on guard. Watch and pray. Watch and pray. See, when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying, they was asleep. They wasn't watching. They wasn't even praying. Just watch and pray. And you don't have to bend your head down. Because again, Yahweh is up here. Look up. There's several accounts. Jesus looked up and prayed. And he looked up and gave thanks. So let's follow Christ's example. All right? Thank you so much for this talk. God bless you. And we'll just keep on doing that. How about that? Anyhow, how you living? Fine, because what we're going to do is just keep talking it up to Yahweh. And I want you to get into the habit of saying, Hallelujah, Yahweh. 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 Ah, they tricked you, right? Hallelujah. It's Hallelujah, Yahweh. Give him praise. Any way you can, give him praise. God bless you. Thank you. Until we talk again, keep talking it up. Faith, the spiritual warfare, life produced, the tongue produced life or death. Use your tongue to speak life, okay? Use your tongue to speak life. With that being said, I always say with that being said, because I can go on and on and on. But I don't want to keep you too long. I know you got your family, you got this, that, and everything else to do. You got to start making videos and doing stuff yourself so you can get the name of Yahweh out there, whose name is great throughout the land. Amen? His name is Yahweh. Remember this teaching. Alpha, Omega, beginning, the ends. You be the judge. Who's beginning? Who's ends? Is it really yours or is it theirs that they want you to believe? Your beginning started like this and your ending ends up like this? God, thus saith the Lord, he begs to differ. I beg to differ. That's not God's plan for your life, and it surely isn't our plan for our life, so we can do something about it. And that's fellowship with one another and bring one another into remembrance of Yahweh, okay? The creator of us all. Thank you so much. You making me feel comfortable. I was this way over on Facebook at first. Jeremiah 1:8. If you have a problem facing people, your enemy, people make you afraid. You're afraid to come forward because of what people are going to say about you. Jeremiah 1:8 says, be not afraid of their faces, for I will deliver you from them, thus saith the Lord. Alright? Don't be afraid. Fear is false evidence appearing real. It's false evidence. All of it. Religion, the Christianity, a lot of things we've been taught is all to keep us bound. All to keep us oppressed. All to keep us down. Jesus says, look up, look up, look up. Look to the hills from where your help come from and look to the hills that have 1,000 cattle on it. Look up. That's all I can tell you. And keep talking it up to Yahweh because he has all the answers. He knows the solution. The spirit in you will be a witness to the spirit in him. And we will be spiritually okay with that going on in our life. So, the name of Yahweh is right here in the Bible. It's not hard. Just train yourself to start calling him Yahweh and Yeshua. Get that title God out of there. Make it more specific. Then it becomes a personal relationship with you and your creator. Thank you. Subscribe, like, subscribe, like, subscribe, like. Thumbs up, thumbs up, thumbs up, thumbs up. Thank you.